Well, the Premier of KwaZulu-Natal, Sihle, Zikalala, has confirmed that on behalf of the Provincial Government and the people of KwaZulu-Natal, he has submitted a request to President Cyril Ramaphosa to grant the departed Regent of the AmaZulu Nation, Queen Mantfombi Dlamini Zulu, with a state-funded funeral. Her Majesty the Queen passed away on Thursday. Our KZN reporter, Simphiwe Makhanya, has now moved from Nongoma in KwaZulu-Natal, where he was stationed at the Royal Palace, and is now in Ulundi in KZN, where he will be chatting with Prince Mangosuthu Buthelezi. Let's cross to him now. Very good afternoon to you, Simphiwe. I think that was a quick drive you made there on behalf of SABC. Over to you then.
Thank you very much, Flo. Good afternoon to you and good afternoon to the viewers as well. Like you have said, Flo, we have been in KwaNongoma for the better part of this day today, but we are no longer there now. We are in Ulundi to have an opportunity to engage Prince Mangosuthu Buthelezi in his capacity as the traditional Prime Minister of the AmaZulu Nation with regards to the developments in the Royal House. Prince, thank you very much for affording us this opportunity. Perhaps if one may ask, in terms of the processes up to now, where are we? Do we know anything, if at all, in terms of the funeral arrangements, the dates and so on?
Well, actually, I'll make a statement about that, because I stated that I would do so in due course. But so far, what I know is that the body of the princess, the regent, the regent of the Zulu Nation, will be brought down from Johannesburg on Wednesday, and I think that on Thursday, I think it will be in the palace. And then the following day, there'll then be a service. And I spoke to the Premier, and the Premier told me that he had approached the President to find out whether he can declare the memorial service, a provincial funeral.
Prince, let's now look at the recent developments, the court processes which are now expected to unfold. We understand that some of the princesses have taken the matter of the will to court, questioning the authenticity of that will, and also the issue of the king's first wife, Princess Sibongile, in terms of her challenging the appointment of an acting regent or a regent going forward. What do you make of these court processes that are going on now?
I think most of the members of the royal family are actually quite shocked by what she has done, because she was still in mourning, and they, as the widows of the king in particular, and the children of the king in particular, are still in mourning. And for them to rush to court in the manner they have done has actually disgraced the royal family. And actually, we think that it will stand out in history as one shameful thing that was done by a queen during the mourning period of her husband. And I think that it's unfortunate that now we have this blow again where the regent has passed away, because she wanted to froze the funeral of the regent, but now unfortunately she has now passed on. But I was told, by the senior member of the royal family, that is the widow of His Majesty King Cyprian Peguzulu, Nyangayizizwe kaSolomon, Queen Mavis Mazungu, told me that she had received the summons, and that she has received some summons have been received also by three of her sons. And I was told by the chairman of the Ingonyama Trust Board that she has also been summoned. And then later I heard also that some of the children of the king and other members of the royal family have received these summons from the first queen of the late monarch of the Zulu nation. I think it's a shameful thing, which shames not only us, shame herself, but shames all of us as members of the Zulu nation, that she should do a thing like this at this time.
Prince, looking...
And in fact, she does this when she still has to account for the thousands and thousands of money that the nation has donated for the widows during the mourning, during this time of the death of the husband, because there was a meeting of the royal family which I presided over, where she promised that she would deliver some of the money, to other widows, and they were also present when I presided over the family meeting. But up to now, she hasn't done so. And one must assume, therefore, that she is using that money to do this shameful thing that she has done.
Prince, speaking of the meetings, we understand that the issue of meetings being called without you knowing. I'm saying we understand that there have been meetings before which have been called without your knowledge. That is still the case. We are seeing voiceovers or voice notes circulating on WhatsApp by some members of the royal family calling meetings. What do you make of this, Prince?
Well, actually, it surprises me, because this thing started when two siblings, children of His Majesty King Cyprian Peguzulu Nyangizizwe Solomon, Princess Tembi and Prince Mbonisi, held a press conference in the yard of the palace in Kwekhethomthanda. In my presence, I was present when they did so. They were assisted by Mr. Mtaga to do this. And actually, that evening, there was a family meeting at the palace where the matter was discussed, why they did this. And in fact, they apologized. And we thought that there was the end of it. But really, the queen, actually, at that time, was still alive, you know, and in all her senses. And the discourtesy was amazing, that after they knew that the queen had been actually announced through the will of the king, they should have done that. I mean, the most senior member of the royal family, Queen Mazungu, did not know about it. All the widows of the king didn't know anything about it. I didn't know anything about it, you know. And they know that the royal family has decided that I should make all the announcements, you know, just in order that there shouldn't be confusion. But they continue to do so, to my surprise, because I hear even today there's another meeting that they've called. And in fact, it's a disgrace that any member of the royal family, let alone the son, the siblings of King Cyprian, should do this during, you know, when the body of the regent is still in the mortuary, when she has not even been buried. It's a very un-African conduct that at this time, anything like that, that people should discuss matters like this by themselves. And I think that there's a mistake when they think that because they are siblings of the king, the two of them, that they comprise what you can call the royal family just because they are children of the king. And actually, I really don't know what they're up to, but it's another disgrace during this very sad period when we've lost our king and now when we've lost our regent. It's disgraceful, to say the least. And I also wanted to comment about something. Last week, I think you interviewed me concerning the death of the regent, and you pressed me to say what killed her, and I said I didn't know, but what information I had was that there were toxins in her liver, in fact, which made it difficult for the surgeons to do a post-mortem. And therefore, they tried a couple of times to decide to do so, and they didn't do so. But the way toxins and poison, toxins in a medical term, and even now, you know, I see that one so-called analyst, political analyst, you know, an idiot, Lukona Mguni, as in today's media, he called me that, you know, my age has eroded my caution, and suggested, in other words, that when I make this announcement to inform the nation that there's something wrong with my mind, I think it's his mind that needs some reading, because all the things he's accusing me of are nonsensical. She said, I promised that the king's will be read in public. It was, in fact, read in the presence of more than 300 people, and it was in public, in fact. I never said that. I don't know whether she means that I was going to pin it all over the country, or I don't know what she means by the fact that I did so. And I also said that the intention was that the body of our late king was going to lie in state in the palace, which is what I did in 1968 when my first cousin, King Cyprian Peguzulu Solomon, died. I was also in charge of the arrangements, and in fact, she did lie in state, and we did have a plan to do that, but later on, after I discussed, we realized that it wouldn't work out because of the COVID-19. I don't know what that is to do with my mind, you know, for this man to go to the public posturing as a political analyst to talk such balderdash about me.
Prince, let's now look closely at these developments. When you talk about these meetings, parallel meetings which are being held by some members of the royal family, one may perhaps come to an opinion that they are undermining your role as the traditional prime minister of the AmaZulu Nation. Are you in fact still the traditional prime minister of the AmaZulu Nation?
In fact, you know, in the media, I've appealed, you know, to these so-called experts, these gurus. I've appealed to them that really they should respect the feelings of members of the royal family while they are mourning by not dabbling in these things about succession. In fact, even mentioning names of who is going to be the heir and so on. It's because these people are part of that. In fact, I know one of the people who's behind this was quoted saying that, she was quoted saying that they will not be ruled by that woman, referring to the regent. She's one of those who are behind this and actually accused me of colluding with the Swazis, referring to the family of the king at Kwakhangela Makengane as Swazis, merely because, you know, the queen is a Swazi by birth, you know. These are the kind of people who are right in the middle of all this unnecessary and shameful, you know, dabbling in the matter of succession while we're mourning.
Prince, these challenges which are facing the royal family, what in your view is going to be the future of the royal family when you have these feuds between members of the royal family taking place publicly?
No, I'm very calm about it. I think that, as I said, when I issued a statement to the media, I say they won't provoke him. I mean, what the king did will carry that out in accordance with the king's wishes. The king has indicated these wishes because in Zulu society, when a man, you know, appoints a woman, it means that that woman, the heir will come from that house. They shouldn't create confusion when there's no confusion about that. It's quite obvious. I cannot say that who of these children is going to be the heir, but you know that in our society, we have the law of primogeniture. It's likely that the eldest son would succeed. They shouldn't create this confusion because really there's no confusion. It's just because some of them have got favorites. They think that they can choose who should be the king of the Zulu nation, whereas we must respect the wishes of the king, whether we like them or not.
The issue of appointing the next king, you know, I know you've been saying let's not rush into the issue of succession and so forth, but looking at what all these things that are happening surrounding this process, when can we likely have that announcement with this court process?
Morning now, it's going to be morning, but certainly there's going to be a series of meetings of royal family, and I can't therefore at this time when we're talking about funeral arrangements now be talking about when that is going to come, because that will be a matter of agreement by members of the royal family.
But as far as you are concerned, you are still the traditional prime minister of the AmaZulu Nation, and you will continue communicating the message of the royal family.
I'm amused by your fact of saying I'm still, because that's the fact that I am that. You know, whether people like it or not, I am that. You know, I'm not posturing. I've been in this position for more than 40 years, long before the late king was actually even born, you know. And in fact, many times I appealed to him to appoint his own traditional prime minister there, because there were people who either for political reasons, you know, such as this book of the ANC called Kacha, a chief with a double agenda, where they defame me and demonize me. Actually, they try to question my position. I've never said that the Buthelezis were traditional prime ministers, because each prime minister is appointed by the king. You know, from the time of King Shaka, my ancestor, the first one to be in the royal court, was Ngangalele. And if you can read even books like Stuart, and you'll see that, in fact, I'm in this position, succeeding people, a person such as Ngangalele, who was the most senior, the prime minister at that time was actually Ngomane of the Nation. It was Ngomane who was, but Ngangalele was most senior. In fact, Stuart says that he was the only person sometimes, because he had brought up the king's children, who could say to His Majesty King Shaka, "Mfana, boy," you know. But then after that, during the reign of King Pande, the children at the royal court in Ulundi were heard crying now and then, and the King Pande would say, why are my children crying? And the people would report that Mnyamane was giving them a whacking, was thrashing them. So from that time, King Pande then announced that Mnyamane from that time is regarded as the father of his children, to the extent that the king later tried to but offered the hand of one of his children, Princess Mtabai, a full sister to Prince Hamu of Kongenichen, to Mnyamane. And Mnyamane declined and politely said to the king, "I can no longer marry any of your children, you know, because we have said that I'm their father." I mean, I got very confused when I was still young, when very senior members of the royal family would refer to me as Baba, father, such as Prince Peter Munyana Katini Zulu, the Prince of Kwaxolani, who was the second, you know, in rank after King Solomon. They would say Baba to me. Even King Cyprian, I remember during the meeting in 1954, when we were preparing to go to unveil King Shaka's article. When the meeting was going on and he wanted a break, and I politely said that no, we can't have a break. Okay. He said, "Oh, Safa Baba, we wanted, you know, a comfort break," and he said Baba to me.
Okay.
You know, even Prince Ndesheni,
Prince, we thank you.
The son of Ndabu, the full brother, to used to say so. Then later, Mnyamane then became a friend of a friend of Prince Gejoyo before he was king. But when he became king, he then appointed him as commander-in-chief, you know, of his regiments and also prime minister. Right. And then after that, during the Dlamini Zulu was brought up at Ekushumayeleni in Mnyamana's place, homestead. Okay. He was brought up by Mnyamana, you know, and even reached puberty. He was in Mnyamana, is what he called. I'm just trying to show that, you know, it's nonsensical to say that I've ever suggested that. Then King Solomon in 1925 appointed my father when the Prince of Wales, who later became King Edward VIII, visited South Africa, and there was a big gathering of Zulus at a show. King Solomon announced prime minister was my father, Mantfombi. He was. Inkosi Albert Luthuli used to tell me, he was my mentor, Albert Luthuli, that often when they were in Mbizos, they would go to my father and say, what does Prince Mshieni, because he was also prime minister during the interregnum, during the time of Prince Mshieni. They would ask him, what is the regent saying about this? And that Inkosi Luthuli used to say he admired my father, because my father was completely literate.
Okay.
He would say that.
Prince, due to time constraint, we have to leave it here for now, but we thank you very much.
I was appointed by King Cyprian in 1954 myself, and I've already told you that I often said to the late king, he must appoint his own, but he, all the time, everyone knows that for all Amakhosi, all of them, and everyone who has lived for the duration of my lifetime knows that from that time I was even in matters between his wives.
All right. Okay.
I adjudicated. Okay. Even when there were differences.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Prince Buthelezi. Due to time constraints, we'll have to stop this conversation here. But indeed, we'll continue to be here to monitor the developments surrounding the royal family and, of course, the processes leading up to the funeral.
Thanks very much to Simphiwe Makhanya.